Lord, we know while we're here today, there are many who are feeling sadness for the loss of Mrs. Vega. But Father God, we know, Lord, that she rests with you today, Father God, that she has life eternal with you, Father God. And we thank you because it should be a celebration, Father, because we know that she is in heaven today and she is rejoicing, Father God. So we shall, while we may be sad, this family may be filled with sorrow as they look back on a life that they no longer see every day, Father God, but they are ensured that she is living a life of fullness in glory, in heaven with Father God. And we thank you, Father. We ask you, Lord, to strengthen the family today. Bring them comfort. Surround them, Father God, with peace, with joy, with love, Father God. For they know who you are, and you are God Almighty. You hold every tear, Father God, in the palm of your hand, Father. And we thank you, Lord. We thank you, Father God, because there is joy everlasting, Father. There is peace everlasting, Father God. Thank you, Lord, for all things that you are doing. We thank you, Father God, for these family, Lord. We ask you just again, Father, bless them and keep them strengthened and encouraged during this time. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you. And the Psalms 90, verses 1 to 12. Lord, thou hast made our dwelling place in all generations, before the mountains were brought forth, wherever thou hadst formed the earth and the world, even from everlasting to everlasting, thou art God. Thou turnest man to destruction, and sayest, Return, ye children of men. For 1,000 years in thy sight are but as yesterday, when it is past, and as a watch in the night. Thou carriest them away as with the flood. They are asleep in the morning. They are like grass which groweth up. In the morning it flourisheth and groweth up. In the evening it is cut down and withereth. For we are consumed by thine anger, and by thy wrath are we troubled. Thou hast set our iniquities before thee, our secret sins in the light of thy countenance. For all our days are passed away in thy wrath. We spent our years as a tale that was told. The days of our years are 70 years, and if by reason of strength they are 80 years, yet is the strength labor and sorrow, for it is soon cut off, and we fly away. Who knoweth the power of thine anger, even according to thy fear, so is thy wrath. So teach us to number our days, and we may apply our hearts unto wisdom. May the Lord have blessing for you.
The New Testament reading is 1 Corinthians 15, verses 51 through 57. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. For the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, Death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory. For our
The sky shall unfold, preparing his entrance. The stars shall with thunders of grace. the angel will sound. The shepherd is coming. And oh, the sleeping, they're going to rest from their slumber,
Pastor Irma Williams, founder, pastor, Minnie. of the master, weaver. Our lives are but fine weavings that God and we prepare. Each life becomes a fabric plan and fashion in his care. We may not always see just how the weavings intertwine, but we must trust the master's hand and follow his design. For he can view the patterns upon the upper side, while we must look from underneath and trust in him to guide. Sometimes a strand of sorrow is added to this plan, and though it's difficult for us, we still must understand that it's he who fills the shovel. It's he who knows what's best. So we must weave in patience and leave to him the rest. Not till the loom is silent and the shuttles cease to fly, shall God unroll the canvas and explain the reason why. The dark threads are as needed in the weaver's skillful hand as the threads of gold and silver and the pattern he has planned. With heartfelt sympathy, Dr. Riddell. Zoraida Mata Vega was born on March 24, 1925, in Union de Reyes, Cuba. She entered into her final rest on Sunday, January 8, 2017. She was fondly called Martha. She married Juan Vega and came to the United States in the late 1950s. From Juan Vega, she married Juan Vega and came to the United States in the late 1950s from Havana, Cuba. She lived in Manhattan, New York for over 40 years before relocating to New Windsor, New York in 1997. Martha was an excellent homemaker. She enjoyed sewing, knitting, crocheting, and above all, cooking. She was very hospitable, and when visiting her home, she insisted on feeding you. While living in Manhattan, she assisted her husband as the superintendent of an apartment complex. And when any of the residents in the building fell sick, she would be at their door with a hot meal or just a kind word. When residents needed assistance or childcare, they could count on Martha to lend a helping hand. Anyone who met her loved her. Besides her husband, the greatest love of her life were her children and grandchildren. Family was always her top priority. She was preceded in death by her husband, Juan Vega, and three sisters and two brothers. She leaves to celebrate her life her son, Enrique Vega Miriam, of Wappinger Falls, New York, her daughter, Marisol Vega Malloy Ralph, of Wallkill, New York, granddaughter, Jessica Vega Malloy, and grandson, Ralph Paul Malloy, Jr., both of Wallkill, New York, along with a host of nieces and nephews who reside in Cuba and Spain, and dearly loved friends. Martha leaves us fond memories. Her gentle smile will surely be missed. She held on to life with joy, peace, and happiness until the very end. However, God called her home, and she surrendered her life to the eternal will of God, where she now resides. We, who are left behind, can comfort ourselves knowing that Zoraida Marta Vega is in a better place, in perfect health, and residing in the presence of God.
say amen.
Amen.
Yes, sir.
When is he good?
All the time.
All the time. And we thank God that we're here at home.
I'm going for mother.
Mommy.
Mommy, we called her Mommy.
I never called her Mrs. Vega. I never called her Zariah. I never called her Martha. I called her Mommy. Because that's what Enrique and Grandpa called me. I called her too. Why? Because I felt just like a part of the family. Just have a few funny things to share with you in regards to Mommy Vega. When I wanted to marry Marisol, I went down to meet her family. She had me scared to death.
This man has hands up, son. This man's hand is twice as big as mine.
So I knew I better be careful when going to talk to Mr. Vega. But Marisol wasn't fair what she did to me. We were dating. I'd have to meet her on the corner to pick her up to take her out because she didn't know how her parents were going to accept me. But after a while, we thought it was safe to go. So I go in and I took a present to her mother, and when I came into the house, Marisol said, my mother cooks every night. And she does, she was a cooker. Mommy always cooked. So I come in and I'm greeted by the parents, because you don't just go marry a Spanish woman's Spanish daughter without asking the father first. It should be like that in the USA. Anyway, I used to call Jessica, he ain't married, you just come to see me first. That's a family tradition. So anyway, I go in and I'm going to nervous to talk to her father. He had 3 TVs on. I didn't understand that for nothing. I said, well, okay, this must be a Spanish tradition, there's 3 TVs. But her father loves sports. He had 3 different games on. And watching all 3. And I'm sitting there nervous and shaking as if, well, okay, I guess when he finished watching this TV. So there's all body said, Poppy, Ralph wants to talk to you. He said, what? He says, okay, so clip with one TV, clip with the other TV, and clip with the other TV. So I said, Mr. Meg, I'm here wondering if I'm wanting to get your permission to marry your daughter. He said, do you love her? I said, do you not love her? He goes, fine. Let me turn on the TV. Now, I told you her mother is a fabulous cook. Always cook. That night, Mommy decided not to cook. Marisol said, she just did that to upset me. I'm not hungry anyway. So I gave her a gift. This is probably Greek family. I gave her a beautiful crystal vase. After she got that vase, because she loved those family things, she said, Marisol. So Marisol goes over and she said, what does a lovely like? Does he like steak? Does he like pork? She says, nothing, Mommy. You get cooked, just forget it. So, but from that point on, every time I went there, she always had too much food. I thought, gee. But one thing she would do, she would feed you until you couldn't breathe. Honestly.
Oh my God.
And you could eat that food forever.
Oh my God.
So, the more she gave me, the more I ate. And she told Marisol, a lot of me eats like a Spanish man, because I love rice. But I told my mother, and I really went against my mother's will. I went against something I promised my mother. I said, when I leave your house, Mabel, my Lord, I eat another bean as long as I live. And I married Spanish woman. So there was that. But again, Spanish words sound so rich. When people speak Spanish, they sound rich. They sound just great. So she feed me, like I said, and she feed Irish. So after eating all that food, my mother would say, I love you. You got it.
Uh-huh.
One of those. But I thought, well, that's a nice nickname. Mary said, you know she called me, don't you? I said, that was a nice old Spanish name. She said, you're a fag. She called you a fag. She called you a fag. And then Irish went down. She used to be Irish all the time.
Oh my
my God.
And again, she took out Gordita. Gordita. She took out, oh, what a cute name. And I said, I was going to just call you. She called me fat. She called me fat. I was kind of shocked by that. But Mommy always is hospitable. Never we'd go down there, she would pack. We could never go down to her house and come home empty handed. She gave us food after food after food after food. And guess what we did? We ate and we ate and we ate. Because she really, really was. She should have opened her own restaurant. She was really that good. But we thank God for her, a wonderful woman who loved her children. Oh God. We could bother anybody, we couldn't bother them children. And she always showed us love. She was always very pleasant to me. She would always send Poppy out to get soda. Lovely soda, good soda. We were served in the house of Lovely and soda. But again, wonderful woman. And I think the greatest joy from the shut up to this was the day Marisol was telling me in the car, even though her mother knew the Lord, but her mother accepted the Lord. I think last year she gave her she put this. And she accepted Christ again as a personal Savior. Which made me happy. I mean, I was okay once I knew that she had made that commitment to the Lord. And because of that, we know where she is. Amen?
Amen.
Thank you.
Mommy. She was born in a foreign land called Cuba. And after she went to the United States, she would migrate, venturing to a place where they knew not far from their family they would be. And as she and the love of her life toiled in this land abroad, a better life is what they longed to see. Not knowing the language, but somehow they would communicate. Her children, she adored. She taught them wrong from right, trying to instill in them traditions she was taught. A better education she wanted them to know. And in private school, they would enroll. They both would succeed in life from this extreme sacrifice. The Lord blessed, and two grandchildren she would have, of which she was so glad, her Bito and her Jesse, would be such a blessing. With her sweet smile, she's looking down from heaven, saying, I love you all, more than you ever know, and will see you after a while. Loving, submitting, Marisol and Enrique. Acknowledgements. The Vega family wishes to express their sincere appreciation for all acts of kindness, prayers, and support during their time of bereavement. May God bless you and she.
Love.
Your love, who is ever rejoicing in your presence.
Father, we ask for your anointing to rest upon your people, especially the family. Comfort them in the mighty name of Jesus. Undergird them. Lord, you're the God of all comfort, so we know that only you can comfort. You see every tear that they can shed, and even in days to come. So, Father God, we give you the glory and honor and praise. It's that you administer through us words of comfort, and we'll ever give your name all the glory, for you deserve it. You deserve it, Father. We pray in Jesus' name, and the people of God say amen.
Amen.
Can you just say that one more time? Amen.
Amen.
And can you sing it? She was a wonderful homemaker and she loved to cook and for people. She wanted them to eat, so she encouraged them, as you have all found out. She would encourage them to eat, and then after she would say, be careful, you can get fat. There were other favorite things that Martha loved to do. She loved to crochet and was fond of shopping for fabric, as she was passionate about sewing. And after she and Juan, who she affectionately called Juanito or Juani, am I doing it right? They moved to Manhattan. They had two children, Enrique, who she called Henry, and Marisol, who she called Sol. Martha's family was blessed with Miriam, Henry's wife, Pastor Ralph, who she called Ralphie. I'm doing good. Then along came two grandchildren, Jessica, who she called Jesse, and Ralph Jr., who she called Ito. And I'm told when people needed assistance, she was always available to assist them. However, when people became a nuisance and got on her nerves with complaints, she would purposely speak Spanish, even though she knew how to speak English. To know Martha was to love her. I remember meeting Mr. and Mrs. Vega many years ago when Apostle took me down to meet them in Manhattan, and it was a joy to meet them. They were so gracious, and I'm forever grateful to have made that acquaintance. But today we're going to look to the Lord because He is our refuge.
Yes.
He is our fortress and a shelter, and in times like these, we need the Lord Jesus as our rock and rest. As I was before the Lord, He gave me a few things to say, and I'm going to quickly say them, and we will receive the morticians to do what they are going to do best. But in Revelations, I understand Revelations 14 and 13 says, "And I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, Write, blessed are the dead which die in the Lord. From henceforth, yea, saith the Spirit, that they may rest from their labors, and their works do follow them." There is always comfort in the remembering how the loved ones we had touched our lives and made it different. There is comfort in remembering that death is not the end. You see, death is not death if you know the Lord. It is merely a change of place, a change of state, a transfer from one realm to another. Death is not death if it raises us in a moment from darkness to light, from weakness to strength, from sinfulness to holiness. Death is not death if it rids us of doubt and fear, sickness and disease, of sorrow and sadness. Death is not death, for Christ has conquered death so that all those who trust in Him might have eternal life. I'd like to refer to those who die in the Lord as having received a pass. Someone might say, "What do you mean by a pass?" Well, when in public school, I would get a pass to go through the corridor to another place in the building. And if I were stopped, they'd see I had a pass that gave me permission to travel to where I needed to go. Perhaps the nurse's office, the front office, or the bathroom, because at that time, the bathrooms were not in the classrooms as they are in some of the schools today. Well, I'd like to say that Martha received a pass early Sunday morning. And that pass allowed her to go through the corridor from earth to heaven. No one and nothing could hinder her travel. She had received proper and divine authorization. A pass, what does that mean? Permitted to gain access into the secret shelter. Permitted to gain access into the secret shelter. There is comfort in knowing that Zoraida, Martha, Vega had established a relationship with Christ through faith. In fact, her daughter, Pastor Marisol Malloy, led her in the sinner's prayer several years ago. There is comfort in knowing that you can see her again. You can see Martha again if you are born again. Our greatest comfort is found in Christ. Jesus said, Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Jesus has promised through the writer of Hebrews, I will never leave you nor forsake you. And it is through a relationship with Christ that we are able to say, as the psalmist, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. We are not given a choice whether to meet death or even to meet death, only how to meet death. Life is brief, and the scriptures tell us that life is brief. In fact, James 4:14 speaks of life being a vapor. Life is short when compared with eternity, yet we have plenty of time to prepare for death. The fact is that we may not remain here very long, but we know that we're living in the last days. The question is, where shall we go? Sooner or later, it is certain that we all will meet death, for the scriptures note, it is appointed unto man once to die, and after death the judgment. The fact is, where shall we go? The fact is, it should cause us to examine our lives. With a look back, what has our life been up to this point? Are you satisfied with it in the face of eternity? And with a look forward, what do you place your hope for the future? And what are you trusting today? If today were the final day of your life, would you be ready? We must realize that we have a choice. Life is full of choices. And there are two places that we can spend eternity, whether in heaven or in hell. And according to the word of God, Jesus says, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. And if it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And the Lord prepared a place for Martha. And he says, if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, so that where I am, you may be also. Jesus said also that I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. There are two ways that we can meet Jesus. We can meet him either as our Savior in this life or as a judge in the next. Jesus said in John's Gospel, the 11th chapter, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he die, yet he shall live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this? And so we believe and know that as a born-again believer, we shall see Martha again. God is always seeking to guide our choices. He gives us the Bible. He gives the church. He gives us a conscience. And he gives us the prayers of family and friends. He gives the Holy Spirit to convict us of sin and righteousness and judgment to come. And with these, God seeks to guide our choice. And indeed, we must climb over all the obstacles in life and recognize that God has made a way for us to overcome and find rest in him. Again, Jesus said, come unto me, all ye that labor, and I will give you rest. We who have accepted the Lord Jesus as our Lord and Savior find rest in Jesus. And those who are not saved, those who are not born again, will receive rest if they come to him. For here he promises to give us a rest. Nothing can be freer than a gift. And God has given Martha a rest. She is entered into an eternal rest. In this life, we can enter into a rest in this world, but the eternal is what we look forward to, because each one of us will have to face that one day. You can't buy it. You can't borrow it. But God promises to give it to us when we ask. Our labor under the lash of ambition or covetousness or lust or anxiety. He says he will give us the rest that we need if we come to him. Jesus, again, gives rest. It is so. Will you believe it? Will you put it to the test? Will you do so at once? He says, come to him by putting every other hope and trusting everything with him. If you thus come to him, the rest which he will give you will be safe, will be holy, and will be everlasting. Again, he gives rest which develops into heaven, and he gives it this day to all who come to him. One day, Martha boldly faced this challenge and said the sinner's prayer that guaranteed her rest and guaranteed her a pass, the permission to gain access into the secret shelter. If you desire to accept this same rest, Jesus promises to give it to you. And you can, if you desire today, to pray a prayer that Martha prayed. I am closing, but before I close, I want to say that this is a prayer most similar to what she prayed when her daughter led her to the Lord Jesus Christ. And if you do not know the Lord Jesus and you would love to see her again, you can pray this prayer with me. And I'm asking everyone to stand with the exception of the family. She prayed this, dear God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. And if you desire to see her again, and you desire to experience a wonderful relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, you can pray this prayer just as she did, along with me. I acknowledge that I am a sinner, and I am sorry for my sins. I believe that your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, shed his precious blood on the cross at Calvary and died for my sins. And I am now willing to turn from my sin. If you desire to pray this prayer, the rest of it with me, you can say, I confess with my mouth, Jesus is Lord, and I believe in my heart that God raised him from the dead. I believe that Jesus, the Son of God, shed his precious blood on the cross just for me. Father, you said, if I confess with my mouth and believe with my heart that God has raised him from the dead, I will be saved. This very moment, I accept Jesus Christ as my own personal Savior. And according to your word right now, I am saved. Thank you, Jesus, for dying for me and giving me eternal life. Amen. Father, we thank you for those that have prayed that prayer. We pray, Father God, again for peace for the family and comfort today and the days to come. For Father, we realize that this is a journey that some of us have already entered into, but this family has released their loved one. And Father, we know that even though there was suffering before she passed, there is no more suffering now. For she has a new body, and she is able to walk and celebrate the Lord. She began with you, Father, and she made a decision that she can end with you in heaven. And for these things, we say thank you, Father. We give you the glory. Again, we say all of the glory belongs to you. All of the honor belongs to you. You are our Lord and Savior, and we thank you this day. May your presence always be felt by the family and those, Father, that accepted the Lord Jesus today as their personal Savior. We're asking that you would undergird. May the angel of the Lord encamp around about us. May there no evil befall us, neither any plague come nigh our dwelling. Again, we thank you. At this time, the service is in the hands of the morticians. You may be seated as they come forward.
Invite everyone back here.